Приветствую всех. Очень рад здесь перед вами предстоять, делиться Словом Божьим.
I'm very happy to stand here and to share with you the Word of God. Thank you for giving me such a possibility. Today we will talk about good news. In December of 2019, the first outbreak of coronavirus was recorded. And in January of 2020, the World Health Organization determined that and gave it the status of emergency. Of health emergency, and we know that after that each country started implementing restrictions, forbiddances, quarantines, and we all have gone through that, and we are tired of sitting at home and wearing masks and do not know what will be further. And if any doctor happened to invent a remedy from this virus and say that is it, let us stop this chaos and the virus will be gone without any circumstances, and everybody would say that it's good news, that something has happened to change to good dramatically our life. And today we will talk about good news about Jesus Christ, and this news is quite cooler than the invention of any remedy against any awful illness, because this good news liberates us and gives us eternal life and liberates us from eternal death. Let us pray first. Dear Lord, we thank you that you are our God, that you has created us and then found each of us, cleansed us, so saved us, put us in your presence, and that we are now your church, that we can gather in your name and read your word and listen to your word and think about it. And please make your word understandable for our hearts, for us to know you better, and to bring fruit to your glory. We ask about that. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. I read from Romans chapter 1, verses
16-17. Во-первых, иудею, а потом и Елену. В нем открывается правда Божия от веры в веру, как написано, праведный верою жив.
Because I do not, I'm not ashamed of good news of Jesus Christ, because the truth is open through that from faith to faith. Paul wanted to come to Rome for a long time, and now he writes this epistle to them as a business card about himself, because he wants them to bring to also bring fruit for all nations. And he says, I am not ashamed of good news of Christ, because it is a power of God. I think that if we look at epistles, we will see that many people did not accept good news. You can imagine how Romans would listen to good news for the first time. They hear that there is a man from Judaics, from Israel, who was in essence a representative of a nation who was
captured,
and
and
he is a representative of a person who was executed on cross. And Romans listened to a story about a person who was crucified as a criminal. The first thought would be quite strange. And Christians were told about that they drink blood of Christ and they eat body of Christ. What is it? Cannibalism? People could think, and Paul in 1 Corinthians says that we preach crucified Christ. For Judaic, it was a scandal, and for Hellenes, it is madness.
It was безумие, да? В других словах он говорит юродство, то есть это было непонятно.
It was not understanding for them, only for the chosen who understood, who were given to understand it was good news of God's power. It's a power. Paul writes, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. And I think that, in fact, it is said here that I am proud of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God to salvation for everyone who believes.
Это сила Божия ко спасению всякого верующего. Сила Божия, вот это слово греческое,
the power
сила,
of God, the power, it's a Greek
dynamos,
word,
извините меня, если я неправильно это произнес, но это слово, впоследствии потом называли его динамит, да, называли этим словом динамит.
After that, dynamite, dynamite was named
верующего.
It's a power of God which saves each believer. For I'm not ashamed for the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God to salvation for everyone who believes. It's Romans 1:16. People who do not go to church, they do not understand sometimes why they should be saved. One person asked me very sincerely, you talk about salvation, but from what? You are saved. And when we talk about salvation, I think about the gospel and about Jesus Christ. There are different kinds of salvations, from sin, from addictions, from fears, from illnesses. But in this case, if we look at the context of what Paul writes about further,
Павел говорит в данном случае о спасении от вечной гнева Божия. Именно в следующем стихе уже написано, ибо открывается гнев Божий с неба на всякое нечестие и на всякое нечестие и неправду человека. То есть открывается гнев Божий. То есть Павел говорит, что сила, вот эта благая весть об Иисусе Христе, это сила Божия к спасению каждого верующего именно спасение от гнева Божьего.
And each believer is saved from the wrath of God. The wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men. Then we read in Romans that there are no righteous people. Everybody has sinned, everybody is deprived of the glory of God, and for everybody judgment is in store, and the wrath of God, both for Judaics and for Gentiles. For everybody who have sinned under law will perish under law, and everybody who has sinned without law will perish without law.
Мы быстренько закончим эти стихи, и потом they я хочу особенно обратить внимание на то, каким образом происходит спасение.
And I would like to focus on how salvation happens. And then we read, for I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God to salvation for everyone who believes. There is no prejudice, there is no restriction for anybody. This good news is for everybody, but we understand that the power of God for salvation is only for those who will believe in Jesus Christ. Those who do not believe still stay there, thinking that it is a strange and wild idea. That the word about Christ is madness for those who is going to perish. He says, for the Jew first and also to the Greek. It's interesting. From Scripture, we know that God has chosen a nation from Abraham, and in this nation, Jesus Christ was born, and from them, good news have come, and the first disciples were Israelites, Jews, and from them, after that, the gospel was spread all over the world. Therefore, for the Jew first, and also for the Greek. The Greek means all other Gentiles who did not know God. And then we come to a very interesting moment, which I would like to draw your special attention to. I know that I read these verses for believers who are in church and who have listened to gospel for a long time, for many times. But I would like you to listen to this idea as if you hear it in you. Verse 17, for in it the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, that the just shall live by faith. The righteousness of God, we understand that it is absolute perfection of God. God is a light and it does not have any darkness in it, any evil. He has only perfection and holiness. So this is the righteousness of God, and in Jesus Christ, and in the good news about Jesus Christ, the righteousness of God is revealed for a human being. You remember the verse in Book of Job, when Job was in suffering, which God allowed to happen, and he asks how a person can be can make himself good and justify himself in front of God, how a person can be so righteous to compare himself with God, for God not to judge him, and how a person can reach that, can achieve that. But this verse is about that for in it the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to God, from the faith to faith. So we receive the righteousness of God, which Job thought about, but how to achieve the righteousness of God. And from faith to faith, there are different interpretations over these words. I like the definition that the paraphrase, that it is a paraphrase of Greek words. Faith to faith means only through faith. In other words, it starts with faith and it is ended with faith. So through gospel, the righteousness of God is revealed to us through faith. And to emphasize that, Paul says, as it is written, we understand that it is written in the Old Testament, and he quotes from Habakkuk that the just shall live by faith. So in all Testament, a righteous one also lived by faith, and in New Testament we're justified by faith and reveal and receive eternal life. So this is good news. What Paul wants to share here. And I want to draw your attention to the fact that good news that a believer is justified and receives the righteousness of Jesus Christ through faith. It's a gospel shared by Paul many times when Paul was saying that it was given by God. It is not from men. And he says, the gospel which I share to you is not from human beings, that I received it from Jesus, through revelation from Jesus Christ when he met him. By the way, talking about power of God, I think that Paul, like nobody else, could say that it's dynamite, that it's real for him, because before meeting Jesus Christ and receiving revelation of gospel, Paul was very hard in persecuting church, and after he met Jesus Christ, in some time he goes and preaches gospel. So power of God has changed his life dramatically. So if we read Epistle to Romans, Paul in the first two verses says, Paul is a servant of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle. And in the second, which he's promised before through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures. So gospel is not in, has not been invented by men. It was a design of God for men's salvation. And in Corinthians, in chapter 15, Paul reminds that gospel has been given to us in accordance with the scriptures by God. What is gospel about? What gospel is about? It's the power of God for salvation, through which we receive righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ. The definition, maybe legal definition of gospel, righteous one is in
15 глава, вот с 3 стиха я читаю, что
Corinthians 15, вам, что принял, since, есть, verse 3, that I have shared with you what I have received, that Christ was killed and died in accordance with the scriptures, and then he showed himself. So Paul defines the gospel as follows, that in accordance with the scriptures, God, Jesus Christ died for our sins. In accordance with scripture, he was buried, and then he rose again the third day according to the scriptures, and then he was seen by Cephas, and then by the 12. And I would like to draw your attention to the fact that gospel is the power of God, is the idea of God, is the revelation of God, and it's the design of God.
И еще я хочу сказать из второго определения, которое Павел дал, что Евангелие – это еще
definition of gospel given by Paul, that gospel is historical fact. It's not theoretical
изобретение, да?
Invention, but it's there was a specific time when Jesus was born, specific place where he was crucified, and specific place where he was buried, and then he arose. and when Paul was writing that, there were still living witnesses of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. It was not a theoretical idea, but historical fact, which has proofs. And it is also revelation from God for Paul, which God himself gave him. It wouldn't be interesting for me to know whether we have time, but I would like to say that Paul talks about sin in Romans.
Иудеями, да, с Израилем спасаются и язычники, что было достаточно большим откровением на то время, да, потому что мы знаем, что долго не могли поверить иудеи, что язычники также спасаются. И есть еще одно откровение, которое тоже напрямую касается Евангелия, раз мы уже об этом говорим, то я уже скажу о том, что Израиль сейчас ожесточил свое сердце, и мы знаем, что сам Израиль
now,
вот в данный момент
Now we know that in this historical moment Israel does not accept Jesus Christ. They prefer living by Old Testament, but not accepting Jesus Christ. But Paul writes that it happens until the till certain time for a number of Gentiles to be able to be saved, and after that Israel will also be saved, because promises are hard, and if God said that they would be saved, they would be saved. So the heart is hardened for Gentiles to be able to be saved, and I wanted to come back to justification.
Большую часть послания
for the most part of Romans
или обсуждает или объясняет такую вот вещь. Оправдание, которое мы получаем верою в Иисуса Христа, и оправдание, которое человек получает по закону. Да? И мы понимаем, почему он так это пишет, об этом пишет. Потому что иудеи, мы знаем, что они были глубоко уверены в том, что человек оправдывается, соблюдая закон. То есть есть закон, который Бог установил, что хорошо, что плохо, что грех, что не грех. Есть там какое-то количество заповедей, есть 10 заповедей, есть еще огромное количество других заповедей. Вот если ты их выполнил, то ты оправдался. И Павел очень сильно
If you have fulfilled them, you are justified. And Paul is greatly against this idea. He says that the only justification, that is gospel about Jesus Christ, about what he has done for them, is the way here to receive justification, for us to be justified and be as righteous as Jesus Christ in essence, because he was the only one who was just and righteous, and he went and died for our sins, for us to be, receive justification and to be righteous. And as he focuses on that and emphasizes that, I will explain why I emphasize that. In many places of Romans, he says that a person receives justification only through faith. For example, when I read from verse 3, since from chapter 3, since verse 21. But now the righteousness of God apart from the law is revealed, being witnessed by the law and the prophets. And Paul keeps saying that gospel has been given by God, and it had been written about in Old Testament. Even the righteousness of God, which is through faith in Jesus Christ, to all and on all who believe. For there is no difference. It's the same as in the first chapter, but in more details. For all have sins and fall short of the glory of God. And verse 24, being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God set forth to be a propitiation by his blood through faith to demonstrate his righteousness, because in his forbearance God had passed over the sins that were previously committed. So it is about justification, which is free through faith, through what Jesus has done on cross. And verse 28, therefore we conclude that a man is justified by faith apart from the deeds of the law. This is opposition, counterposition between justification through faith and justification through law. And it was very difficult to accept for Judeans. For in their understanding, they have to do what God has said, and then they will be justified. And for Judaics, at least, it was absolute authority. It was a man chosen by God to make a nation of God from him, and from that nation, Messiah, the Christ, to be revealed. And what was written about Abraham in Roman verse chapter 4,
Авраам сверх надежды поверил с надеждой, через что сделался отцом многих народов по сказанному, так многочисленно будет семя твое. И вот сейчас вот так прихожу к тому,
Abraham,
что я хочу сказать.
God,
и не изнемогшего вере он не помышлял, что тело его почти столетнего уже омертвело, и
утроба
Сарина
hope,
в омертвении не поколебался в обетовании Божием неверием, но прибыл к нему
неверием, воздал славу Богу, God through unbelieving, but he was faithful to God, and because in him that God is faithful to make true what he has promised, and it was accounted to him for righteousness. We all know the story of Abraham. God has chosen Abraham. He led him to promised land. Abraham obeyed God, and God promised that great number of people will be engendered by him. And then he was waiting for a son, but there was no son, and Abraham was 100 years old, and his wife, Sarah's inner elements were also beyond that term. But Abraham continued to believe God, and God gave him the promised son, and that was accounted to him for righteousness, that he believed God. And it also accounts to us for righteousness. Paul sets these examples for us to understand that through faith and not through law we are justified. And how it is related to to what we are reading now, to faith, to righteousness through faith, or righteousness through actions. I talk about that because I think that these two ideas of justifications, they are in parallel. When Paul described the examples of Abraham, now we can see the situation when people look for their justification through their actions. No, we have a Christian country. If we take an average Christian, we ask him if we ask him if you die now, will you go to heaven or not?
And
I will not ask you. Don't be afraid. I know that. But if you ask a brother from Orthodox Church, he will say, "I do not know. I believe in Jesus Christ. I do whatever I can. I try, but it's God's sovereign will, whom to save and whom not to." And so I do not know. That is my statistics of questions. For me, I use this example to emphasize that it's an example of being justified with actions. If you believe that you're justified and receive the righteousness of Jesus Christ through faith with what he has done, with Jesus has done, paying for your sin, how you can say that I do not know, because God says you will be justified with faith and you will be saved from wrath. That if you believe, so if you believe that you're justified, you're already saved and your part is in heaven. But if you think that you do not know and you have yet to do something more, to do some more good actions, though you believe in Jesus Christ, but then that is already justification through actions. And to my mind, if a person says like that, he means that I do not believe that I am justified in Jesus Christ and all my sins have been forgiven. That is very serious. And Paul, when he wrote about that to Galatians, who had heard that justification in Jesus Christ is not sufficient, that they have to do something more, like circumcision. Paul calls them fools. He says, who has enchanted you? It's another gospel, but there cannot be another gospel. If you want to be justified also by actions, you have to fulfill all law. There cannot be a little bit of justification through faith and a little bit of justification through faith. If you want to be justified through actions, you will have to fulfill all of them. But we are justified through the actions of Jesus Christ. Let us look at our people, at Protestants. Can there be among Protestants, there are believers who can lose salvation when they sin? It's sort of a humble idea. They have to try not to sin, but it's the same for me. It's as if you say that if I solve, if I lose salvation when I sin, it's the same that I will not sin and then I will not lose salvation. It's the same as justification by action. And it's not justification, but it's legality which does not save. There are people, let's look at our churches. There are people who live through the feeling of guiltiness. When they have done something, they feel that they are guilty. But how do you read the gospel? Our righteousness, our justification is through faith of Jesus Christ. You cannot be justified in any other way. It's the only thing which is necessary in order to get into the presence of God, to get to heaven. You cannot have even more righteousness. You are absolutely justified. If you have any doubts, then you do not understand understand the righteousness which you receive in Jesus Christ. I had a talk with a very mature Christian, and I tell her, do you know that we as Christians, we have a power to overcome demons in the name of Jesus Christ? I believe that it is right. Though there are different approaches to that in our perspectives on that in our church. And she says, yes, I agree, we have power like that as Christians. But I do not want to do that because I'm afraid. Because what if I have sin and I will command something to demons, and for that sin I will get into trouble? So I'm afraid. And frankly speaking, for me, it is a bright example that a person has not does not understand scripture to the end. We do not have a sin which devil would use against us. If you believe in Jesus Christ, that he has justified you through his death, you are absolutely justified in Jesus Christ. And if you feel guilty and think that a sin can be used against you, or feel dissatisfaction, you should come back to gospel, which says that it's power of God, not our power, but a power of God for justification for every believer. And justification only through faith. It is interesting that people would likely ask a question. And Paul also writes, so shall we sin now? So if we are justified, we can live in any way we want. And people who have not come to God will ask us these questions, because when we receive justification, the next which happens to our life besides salvation and the second thing which comes to us is grace. And Paul writes, that having justified, being justified through faith, we have peace with God, through which we receive the access to grace in which we stand and we boast. Having been justified by faith, we receive grace which liberates us from slavery of sin, any addictions of depressions. In our church, they are afraid to talk about depressions, but Christian must not have depressions, because I do not say about clinical depression as an illness, but God liberates us from a spiritual depression, giving us grace. When people come to God, they are liberated from narcotic addictions because they receive grace of the power of God, and God transforms us, filling us with his power, and it brings us to new life. And there is no judgment for people who receive that. Gospel and grace calls us to holy life, but it comes after justification. So we are justified not with good actions, but with faith. And after that, we receive grace, and the good actions is means consequences of that. that after we are saved, our life is transformed. Because when we try to receive justification with our action, that will be different gospel from what Paul had preached. And my last idea is, before wrapping up, is that we have found out that there is justification which we receive in faith through Jesus Christ. We have found out that there is grace through which we come to new life and we are saved from wrath of God. But in practice, if there are unbelievers among us, I say to tell about that for unbelievers. If somebody has not received the power of God to receive that grace, I tell to them that Paul says that if you declare Jesus Christ with your mouth and believe in your heart, that God has risen him from dead, from the dead you will be saved. For power of God to come to your life, you need faith. And in your mouth, you will have to declare it for salvation. You have to say that Jesus is my Lord, my King, and to say to Jesus that you are my Lord, my King, and everybody who will call the name of Lord will be saved. Let us sum up. I think that we, like Paul, must not be ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Why? Because it is the power of God, it is dynamite. It is something which is not our power, but it's the work of God. And when we share gospel, God changes things. The bright example that is Paul himself. He had been a persecutor of church, but he has turned to be a person who made a lot of great things for Gentiles. And gospel saves us through faith, but not through actions. And gospel is a historical fact. It's not only theory, but something which really took place, and there were witnesses of that. And when we are justified by faith, we receive access to grace of God, which transforms us, and through which we can live in a way which will glorify God. And another thing, I want to remind you that justification is only through faith, and one cannot be justified through actions. If an action happens which you think will justify you in front of God, that is not true, because we will be justified only through faith in God. I only would like to say that we are justified only through faith in what Jesus Christ has done for us. And I want to pray, Lord, thank you that gospel is a power which justifies us through faith. It's not our merits, but it's your mercy and your gift to us. And we ask you for us in fullness to understand understand gospel, to stay in your righteousness through faith and in your grace, and to bring a lot of fruit, to see salvation in our life, and to be courageous in preaching a gospel in order to see salvation around us, in our families, in our works, in our country, for the people around us to understand what is grace in the name of Jesus Christ. We ask about that. Amen.